Hello, everybody. Welcome into a brand new, exciting TLN Teens podcast. Today, we are joined by a wonderful guest, Victoria, who is the owner of the food brand Sunmo. I'll let her introduce herself further.
Yeah, thank you for having me. My name's Victoria. I'm the CEO and founder of Sunmo. We are a healthy food brand, so we sell health and wellness products. We started with our hero product, which is our plantain crisps, and now we're selling protein, collagen protein, a balanced green, and a berry burn, which is really good for your skin, for if you want to have weight management. And we're selling those direct to consumer. We've sold in Selfridges, Whole Foods Market, and Sainsbury's as well.
Amazing. So today I'll be asking you a few questions based on the beginning of your brand and how you expanded going on Gordon Ramsay's show, and did you and how you enjoyed the experience and your business going further into different places in the market. So my first
Okay.
question today is, how did you come up with the idea of Sunmo, and why start with plantain chips out of many other foods available?
Yeah, so I came up with the idea probably around your age or a bit earlier, actually. I was in secondary school and we was going through what was called the financial crisis of 2008. And whilst I wanted to work in banking at the time, it just showed me there wasn't very much security in that job role. So that's when I started thinking about being an entrepreneur. So it's been a passion of mine for a number of years. I was probably around 15 or 16 years old at the time. And then I just started brainstorming things that I could do. At the time, I used to do hair for my friends and family. I started doing hair when I was like 10 years old, getting paid for it. So I was just thinking about things I can do that were could make me money and could make me an entrepreneur, and where I wouldn't have to trade my time for a paycheck, essentially. I thought that quite early on. And then I went into food because I started researching the size of the market. I'm passionate about cooking as well, so I used to bake for my family. And I had so many business ideas before. I had the idea of a bakery. I pitched a couple of stores. I was selling my cupcakes in at events and things. But I just realized with a baked goods company, I had to turn around products very quickly. So I had only like 3 days for them to be produced. So everything that I've created today has been very true to myself. And then the plantain crisps, because I am of Nigerian heritage, it's something that we eat. And I thought, you know what, this is a great opportunity for me to bring this to the mass market. I don't really see it in, let's say, Waitrose and Sainsbury's and Selfridges. And I want to be that brand that makes plantain crisps, puts it on the map or in the UK, essentially, and Americas, let's say. That's where I came up with that idea.
That's really great. My next question is, was your main aim when the financial crisis hit to become an entrepreneur after you saw your dream of banking sort of not be as secure as you thought it would be?
Absolutely, yes. So I was dead set on becoming an entrepreneur at the time, and still today, I looked up to the likes of Alan Sugar. I would research entrepreneurship, what I need to do. I would ask questions. My family members who had started their own businesses, I would ask them questions. So yeah, that was my backup plan, essentially, to be an entrepreneur.
That's really great. I just want to understand how, like, you raised the funds to start your own business. Like, how did you get your first initial investments? And where did you get them from?
So of course my entrepreneurial dreams started at 16, but going further down the line, I raised investment. So I went to university, and even though I didn't think finance was a secure job, now it is, of course, and it probably always was, but there was the financial crisis. I did go on to study accounting and finance, and then I worked in a bank, a private bank. And at that bank was where I found my two first investors. So I was interning at the bank and we would do events and we'll do like pitching events. And I always put myself forward because I love speaking, I love presenting, I love pitching. So I put myself forward. And two people in the bank, well, a lot of people did find me interesting, I guess. But I asked them to be my mentors, and they asked me what I did outside of work. And this was when I started my plantain crisp business. It was like my outside of work thing that I did. And I said, oh, I've got this small business. I kind of just wanted to change the subject. And they was both like, oh, well, I'm going to invest in you. And that's where, whereas I had a background in accounting and finance, I had already produced the financial forecasts, ready for investment. I knew a lawyer who helped out because I didn't have very much money. And yeah, that's how the ball got rolling, and I got my first set of investors.
That's really interesting, actually. I mean, I'd love to have a career in finance and accounting one day, and I think that would be just a really cool thing to do. So would you say that having a degree in finance and accounting really helped you with the beginning of the growth of your business?
Personally, it helped me only because it really allowed me to push myself further than I would personally. So I pushed myself in learning about how to write a balance sheet, you know, all these financial forecasts, cash flow statement. And that's what university did for me. It also connected me to my investors because I got my internship on my gap year, whilst I was studying. So I would say it did really assist. But I wouldn't say it's the only way. I definitely think that if you are a self-starter, you can self-motivate, you can be an entrepreneur, gain investment without getting a degree.
Yeah, I agree with that. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to go to university to start a business. There's many examples of that I have seen before. Obviously starting your business, how long did it take for you to blow up, so to speak, and get onto like the shelves of like Sainsbury's and Selfridges, as you've mentioned previously?
So after getting investment, it all happened very fast. So after we got the investment in March of 2019, we launched and used that investment to go to a couple of trade shows and to get the first production of the product, so get a manufacturing run done. And we spoke to Selfridges and I believe Sainsbury's, a lot of the big retailers at this one trade show in March 2019. And we launched into Selfridges in June of 2019. March, April, May, June. So like 3 months later. And then I believe it was a couple months after that, we launched into Whole Foods Market. And then about a year after that, we launched into Sainsbury's. So it all happened within the first 2 years of business.
That's really quick actually compared to other brands. So next question involving obviously you mentioned 2019. The following year of that was of course 2020, in which we had COVID. Did that affect your business in any way? Did that make it better or did that make it grow slower?
It did affect the business. It increased sales only because we was in the supermarkets, and the supermarkets was kind of like the only thing that was open, the only place people was allowed to shop. So it was really helpful for us, and it meant that Sainsbury's gave us quicker payment terms. So they gave us like a 7 day payment term. They paid us within 7 days of us invoicing them, whereas usually you'll get about a 30 to 90 day payment term. So because of COVID, it was actually very beneficial for us. A lot of people was at home. It brought a lot of eyes to the brand. So yeah, it was actually a very positive for Sunmo.
That's really interesting, actually, that COVID helped your business instead of stunting it like it happened to a lot of other ones. On the basis still of starting your own business, what inspiration could you provide to young teens or adults in Nigeria or in any other country in Africa that have the same aims as you to start a business, obviously, whether it's involved in food or clothing?
I think that my inspiration would be, you know, given I'm someone who lives in the UK, but in terms of the stereotype or the norm for someone like me, I grew up in a single parent household. I'm from East London, which was a gang-ridden area when I was growing up. You know, all of these stereotypes that you wouldn't, I was, you know, young, I was the youngest black woman to launch into Sainsbury's. So all of these things that wouldn't usually happen to me. It just, I think I'm just that poster child for you can do whatever you put your mind to, regardless of your circumstances. And I think it's just sheer determination. There's been lots, long hours. I remember getting probably like 3 hours of sleep, producing the products myself by hand. I think a lot of people don't assume that I made these products by hand, that I actually cook and, you know, put in the elbow grease, but I really still do till this day, and I did right from the beginning. So with hard work, thinking smart, definitely, because, you know, I started the business and I had business ideas before, but it was that knowledge of, okay, we can pitch at a trade show, we can speak to buyers at certain places, that knowledge that really elevated us. So it's just, I'm the advice and the inspiration I'd give is you can do whatever you put your mind to, regardless of where you are in the world, regardless of your circumstances, you can do it. And then the motivation or the advice I would give is to connect with others. So even if you're in Nigeria and you've got a family member who's an entrepreneur, connect with them, speak to them. I think I've got so many gems from just speaking to my entrepreneurial uncles and, you know, people in the bank. Like, I was the intern that would take every single person to coffee, and if another intern was like, oh, I took this senior staff to coffee, I'm like, okay, I'm getting that coffee too. And I was just like asking them questions, never feel ashamed and never feel like any question is a dumb question. And if you're just like, okay, I just want to pick your brains because you don't even know where to start, don't feel ashamed to do that too. You know, you can ask the simplest question, how did you start out in your career? What advice would you give to me? Anything. Never feel ashamed. You just have to put the work in.
That's a really inspirational statement there. And I think that actually inspires lots of people, whether they're in the UK or in Nigeria, to start their own business, and gives them motivation to do that. Next question is, do you enjoy being the boss of everything and like overseeing the whole brand and how everything moves and flows? Is that something you really enjoy?
I do. I definitely do. If I was to look back on when I was working for others, I always wanted to do my own thing and create my own path and be in charge of my schedule. So I definitely enjoy having, you know, having the ability to create things. I enjoy delegating. I enjoy things being done properly. So yeah, I definitely enjoy making things that I've dreamt of come to pass. It's been, you know, especially when you've been thinking about it since you was like 10 years old, being an entrepreneur, it's very fulfilling and it feels like exactly what I need to do. I've been thinking about it for so long. I've just had to do it, to be fair.
Yeah, I think personally for me, I'd really enjoy being the boss myself and seeing over people, because I think it'd just be a really cool experience. Do you have like a schedule, like a main schedule that you stick to? And do you think it's important to have a plan of attack, so to speak?
That's a very good question. And I completely do. The analogy that I give most of the time is, if you are trying to get to a destination and you are just like, okay, I'm just going to wing it, I know it's somewhere up this way, and you're driving in your car and you're trying to get there, you probably won't get there. And even if you do, you probably would have gone the longest route and not just a straightforward path, had to ask 101 people along the way. Whereas if you've got a set now where it's like, okay, we're going to go from A to B to C to D, and we're going to get there, right? It's a lot smoother. It's a lot easier. And that's what a plan does. I would say the first 6 months after that investment was planned out very meticulously, like day to day. Saturday, I knew what I was doing. Sunday, I knew what I was doing. Speaking to investors. Even in my plan, I put down pitching Sainsbury's on this day, sending them samples, were launching in their store. Of course, we didn't know if they was going to say yes, but I put it in my plan, and it all happened. So I definitely think a plan is essential.
I agree. I mean, personally, for me, even as a school
Yeah.
student, I need to have a plan with, let's say, my revision, as I had exams recently. My
Really?
revision, I obviously, it was important for me to have a plan schedule, when to revise what subject, how to revise it, and so on. So,
Yeah. You should take that. You could just keep that. I think all the way through your life, it will be so useful. Of course, you don't want to be too, I guess, strenuous on a plan, but it helps a huge deal.
yeah, I agree. So, moving on to the show Food Stars, which you went on with Gordon Ramsay, were you approached by them or did you approach them to go on the show?
So I was sent an email to apply. So I was sent an email to apply. I don't know whether they had seen me and decided to send an email. I'm not sure. But I sent an email to apply, and I did. I applied a day before the deadline, or on the deadline day, or something, which I don't advise to do, but it's just what happened. And the very next day, I got a call saying, "Yeah, we love your application. Do you want to do a Zoom interview?" So it was around lockdown times. So they was like, "Okay, well, do you want to do a Zoom interview tomorrow?" So I did a lot of Zoom interviews and phone calls, and then got on the show. So yeah, that's how it happened.
So, were you happy when you got accepted onto the show? Were you like really
Oh yeah.
overjoyed?
Oh, absolutely. There was about, oh, I don't, I did, I lost count, but maybe like 5 to 7 rounds of interviews. And there was one interview where we was up against the other contestants, and it was kind of like they made us very aware that only two of you are going to get through, and there's four of you in the room, and you're just like, oh my gosh, it's going to be me. And then we had another cut where it was like 15 of us left, but only 12 was going to make the cut. So yeah, I was overjoyed when I heard that I got in. I literally screamed. We were staying in apartments. They put us in these apartments in Canada Water, and I screamed, and she was like, "Be quiet. Some people didn't make it. It's just like, don't celebrate too much." But yeah, I was definitely very happy.
That's really good. I mean, if I was in the same situation, I'd be extremely happy as well, so it's completely understandable. So once you got onto the show, obviously you met Gordon Ramsay. What were your first impressions of him, and did you like him?
So I had a positive impression of him. I didn't have, even though I think because I can be quite like raw at times as well, like Gordon is. So I never thought, oh my gosh, is he gonna shout at us? I'm scared. I wasn't scared whether he was gonna shout at us. I don't think that scares me. So I was just excited to meet him, to impress him, and to win, basically. I was like, that's what I need to do. Meet him, impress him, and win. So yeah, but I got very nervous. I got very nervous when he was around. Like, till this day, I still get very nervous. So yeah.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Yeah, I get really nervous around Gordon Ramsay too. He's a really big star. So,
Absolutely.
behind the scenes filming the show, what was the environment like? Was it positive? Did you make new friends and meet new brands and like that you could join together maybe?
Yeah, so I made a number of friends who I still speak to today. It's really nice to be around other food entrepreneurs. Gordon is amazing. He interacts with the team so well, like off camera. He's literally the nicest person. He's like lovely to the staff, to the runners. Everyone on set has so many positive things to say about him. And especially those who have worked in TV for a while, they'll say, okay, compared to other celebrities, he's actually great. So yeah, made a couple of friends, which was really good. And yeah, kept in touch with a lot of the other foodies. So yeah, it was a really great experience. It was quite isolating because at the same time we're in competition with each other. So we couldn't get too friendly whilst we was filming. But afterwards we're friendly.
That's amazing. It's nice that you made friends on the show. Would have you met any other celebrities involved with food, and did you like them, and who was it really?
Yeah, I have. So I met the winner of Apprentice, Harpreet. She's lovely. She's a big fan of Gordon. So we was at an award show, and she was just like, "Oh my gosh, you won Food Stars!" And I was like, "You won the Apprentice." Apprentice has been a show that I've watched since forever, basically. So yeah, I was so proud of her for winning, and she was just like, you know, I'm so proud of you for winning. And I got her number actually. I need to stay in touch with her. So yeah, I've met a couple of celebrities, gone to a couple of celebrity events. So it's been really nice. Yeah.
Lovely. That's really good, obviously, that you met celebrities and you obviously still keep in touch with them. Obviously you won the show Food Stars. And when you won, were you extremely happy? Like, what were your emotions? And you secured the big investment. What was it like?
I was so happy, extremely happy. I think especially my journey on the show was a very up and down one. Like I had a very protagonist story where I was like on top, and then all of a sudden I got knocked down. Like, and then I had this like woman who was trying to come for me every episode. Like anytime we worked together, she was trying to sabotage, basically. So yeah, it was just the cherry on the cake, because not only do I think I deserved it, but also having gone through the turmoil that I had gone through, and basically being told I don't deserve to be on the show by other contestants. So winning was amazing. It was really, really good.
That's really good. And I mean, I can't believe that other people would try and sabotage you. That's just really crazy. I mean, people would do anything to get their brand on top. So during the show, did you think of any new ideas on how you expanded your brand further? Obviously having protein and all the other stuff that you've expanded with. Did you come up with any of those ideas during the show?
So you hit the nail on the head. So I went into the show, having the plantain crisp and the sweet potato puffs were our only products on our line. And then in the final, Gordon said he wants me to create a new product, that's a drinks product. And I hadn't thought about making a drink before at all. So I was just like, are you sure? But he was like, yep, I want you to play with the big boys. I want you to create a drink. So I was like, okay, fine. So created this drink and it tasted delicious. And then after coming out of the show, I researched the industry and I was just like, this is a perfect industry to go in. It aligns with our brand values of bringing something healthier to the market, because that's what our ethos was, like eat good, do good, feel good. So yeah, so it definitely aligned with what we wanted as a healthy brand, and that's where we came up. So I've got one here actually. That's where we came up with our new product range on the show. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really good. It's obviously a big thing, yeah, expanding into the drinks industry, as there are lots of big competitors in there. So who are your main competitors when expanding into the drinks industry?
So in drinks at the moment, because it's a drinkable powder, it's a powder that you can turn into a drink. At the moment, the main competitors are Athletic Greens, Real Superfoods, Natura, who else? Yeah, those are just to name a few. Ovi Huel is a big one as well.
Yeah, the main competitors, and obviously they're really big names as well. So,
Yeah.
what's it like competing with them? Do you ever feel discouraged, or do you always think, right, I'm going to get my brand on top, sort of thing?
You know, it was at first, it was me. I mean, I never worry too much. Whenever I've got an idea, I just go, especially when I know it's a good product, I just go all in. And then when we first launched it, so the first day I launched it, we got a huge influx of sales. So it was just like perfect. It was like I pressed the go button, live button on the website, and then I got all of these sales come in. So yeah, it's just like go, 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 meet orders, keep up with customers, give them a great customer service. So yeah, I don't feel too discouraged. I'm excited for what's to come.
Yeah, that's really good. And your brand in 5 or 10 years, where do you see yourself?
So Sunmo in 5 years, I want us to sell the com I want to sell the company. I want us to be a unicorn brand, so I want us to be a £1 billion brand, Great British pounds. So yeah, there's a lot of work that's going to go into these 5 years. Yes, definitely expand the product range, expand to the US, and globally, and yeah, become a unicorn.
So yeah, on the topic of expanding, is there one country that you do dream of expanding to, and if so, why?
So I definitely think the Americas at the moment will be our biggest market. However, I do really want to be able to expand to Nigeria and other countries within Africa. I don't know if there's a big enough middle class at the moment, but that's definitely where my heart lies. I think that our products will be great to bring a new feel to the market. The designs are amazing. The ingredients are very fresh. It's such a beneficial product for that type of market. So yeah, I definitely want to be able to infiltrate the African countries.
So, going back to being a unicorn brand and obviously having a £1 billion company, how long do you think it will take you to get there, and how much work do you need to put in?
So I believe we should be able to be there within 5 years. The amount of work I have to put in is just as I'm doing, if not up, accelerate it, make sure that we've got the plan in place. It's just about executing. Make sure that all of our marketing messages are very clear, we're consistent with it, hire the right people, grow the team, to make sure that orders are being fulfilled on time. And yeah, we should be able to do it by doing that. Yeah.
That's really amazing, and good luck to you on that journey.
Thank
So,
you.
obviously, expanding your business, hiring staff, and going to manufacturers. What was my main question is, what was hiring staff like, and what is being the boss of staff like?
Hiring staff can be very difficult, I'll be completely honest. I think when it comes to staff members, there's so many things that you learn in hindsight that you might not know beforehand. I would say we've had our fair share of, just looking at a CV, thinking it's amazing because they've worked at Coca-Cola or they've worked at, Nestle or what have you, but it doesn't really reflect that person's actual ability to work within your team. Or their skill set even, or their experience. So I think it is when you've got a good staff member, so we've had some amazing people who the Sainsbury's launch was just so seamless with them. Our Selfridges launch was seamless with them. So yeah, we've had a really great bunch, and we've also had a couple blips here and there. So it's the backbone of your business, but it can be difficult.
So, next question, moving on. What has been your main high and your really lowest low, expanding your business and growing your business?
So do you know what? Every single year, the highs change. So when I launched into Sainsbury's, that was the biggest high. When Sainsbury's decided to launch us full time, that was another huge high. Then when we launched into Whole Foods Market, that was a huge high. Then when we launched into Sainsbury's, I was over the moon. I was just like, oh my gosh, this is it. Like, I'm so excited. And then we won the investment from Gordon, and I was just like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. So the highs, I can't call just one at the moment. What has topped them all has been Gordon Ramsay, but I wouldn't take any of the other highs away. I wouldn't take that away from any of the other highs because they feel as amazing, to be fair. And the lows, I think the lows have just been just burnout. So not having balance, work overworking and feeling frustrated because you're trying to push yourself, you're trying to do so much more, but you're just so exhausted that you can't. So yeah, that's been the lows, I think.
Yeah, obviously in a business there's lots of highs and lots of lows. But I'm really happy that you've had lots of highs, obviously expanding into the different supermarkets and food chains. That's just really amazing. So I'm trying to remember. Oh yes, when hiring staff, Do you look at do you what do you base it on? Do you base it on like their skill set, or do you when they come in for the interview, do you like look at their personality and see what they're actually like before you hire them?
So now I base it on their personality. I think it'll be really good. It's a probationary period is amazing because you get to give them a task and see how they handle it, right? So that period in itself, because there's only so much you can tell from an interview, and there's a couple things that I look up on, like how long have you worked in your previous company, do referencing, and things like that, which can tell, I guess, the character of a new staff member. But mainly when it comes to giving them a task and how they perform it is how you can really tell how they will be in the long run.
So, leading on from that question, what different jobs do you have at Sunmo, and like, what is the hierarchy at Sunmo?
So the hierarchy, so we've got right now we're just hiring on a needs basis. So cash is king, of course, but content is really important, especially in this day and age. So a marketing managing role is available. Of course, I'm CEO. We've got our board of directors, and then we've got C level. So we've got non-executive directors. We've got an accountancy department, and then or team rather, and then we've got our manufacturers. So right now, it's mainly operations, marketing, and finance. Those three departments, and I would say the higher is quite a flat structure. In that everyone works along each other, so there isn't like I guess a triangular hierarchy.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's quite important, just having like a really good basis to go off of. With marketing, how do you market? Do you market on social media? Do you market on adverts on TV, for example, when there's big events going on, like maybe a football final? Would you market yourself on there, or how do you market?
So we market on social media. We run Facebook ads, email marketing. We market via social media organically, so TikTok, Instagram, Facebook, and we also do well. We have done in-person marketing, so we've done trade shows. We've obviously done our BBC TV show. We've been in a couple other shows appearing. YouTube is a good one as well. So yeah. A lot of online marketing. We've done some press as well. So we've been in Forbes magazine, even in Standard. So publication marketing as well.
That's really interesting. Obviously, I spend a lot of my time on TikTok, so
Yeah.
it's a really good place to market your brand.
Absolutely.
So before Food Stars, did you think about going on any other business shows, for example, The Apprentice or Dragon's Den?
Yeah, so we was approached by Dragon's Den. Food Stars was in the making, so that I didn't see a point of doing both. So we had the reach out to do Dragon's Den, and then yeah, I definitely wanted to do The Apprentice. 100%. That was my show. I actually applied. I didn't get through though. So yeah, I mean there's just so many people. But this was the very early stages of my business. Maybe. After we had launched into a couple of stores, they would have let me on the show. But yeah, definitely wanted to do Apprentice.
So, I think the Apprentice would be a really cool experience, and obviously being associated with Alan Sugar and maybe winning the big investment, I think that would be really cool. So,
Absolutely.
what would you say has been your highest sales day? Was it when you went when you did your drop of your new powder, or was it when you went into Sainsbury's? What's been your biggest sales?
Oh, that's a good question. Biggest sales day, I think it's definitely been so that oh, there's a couple. I need to know the numbers actually. So Sainsbury's is a big one because they order pallets load. So they will order like 3,000, you know, so many of your product, 3,000 packets of your product in one go, 6,000 packets. So that's a huge when Sainsbury's place a purchase order, that's a huge sales day. The final of the show on BBC was a huge online sales day. So retail wise, our Sainsbury's launch was probably the biggest sales day. Online sales, definitely Gordon Ramsay on the final of the show. Yeah.
So, moving again, leading on with pricing and financial status, what do you price your products at? So, like your plantain chips and your powders and your different types of product, what are the prices of those?
Yeah, so this balance screen is currently priced at around £40. It's 30 servings, so this is a month's worth of product. So it's about a pound something per day, so it's quite affordable. Our collagen protein is about the £50 mark. Again, it's 30 servings, and it's really good for your skin, hair, and nails. So you can imagine if you're, in a month, you might buy your thing for your moisturizer or something like that, which will be so pricey. So this is a lot more, it's natural, healthier, and it's a lot more cost effective. And our berry burn is the £50 mark as well. And of course, for when you want to weight manage, it's a cheaper alternative to getting all of these stuff. You still would want a gym membership, but if you get these weight loss pills or all of this stuff that is for weight management, this is the better alternative, all in one, a convenient package. Our plantain crisps at the moment, a box of 12 is about £15 per packet. So yeah, that makes it about £1.10, I believe, each, £1.30. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really affordable and quite cheap compared to other people's products.
Absolutely.
So do you guys pride yourselves at Sunmo? Do you pride yourselves on being organic and being like made from organic materials and natural plants, let's say, or wherever natural comes from?
Yeah. So we pride ourselves, this whole product range is organic. So it's got organic ashwagandha, it's got all of the ingredients are organic in this product. Pride ourselves on being 100% natural. So all of our products are 100% natural ingredients, the highest quality ingredients. That's how we stand out in the marketplace. And I'm personally very passionate about that because I grew up with eczema. So I was born with eczema. And very poor circulation. And I found that it was the food that I was eating that made a big difference. So I healed myself with food, essentially, and not just any food, the healthiest and the highest quality food. So I would take neem leaf powder and eczema that I had suffered with for 20 odd years. It started going away within like 3 days, and I couldn't believe it. That in a combination with cutting out really processed foods. And I just found that, if you don't eat healthy and if you eat processed foods, your skin, it does make a big difference. And your skin is the biggest organ on your body. So whatever you ingest, it will just show up on that organ. So yeah, we pride ourselves in that because I'm personally passionate about it.
So, your products, do they have to go with a healthy, balanced diet as well to work, or do you just have to take them? Or how does it work?
So you could, the thing is of with a healthy balanced diet, it's hard. We're always being advertised McDonald's in every corner or like a chocolate bar in every street. So you don't have to be too strict. The good thing about our products is it's nutrient rich. So if you find that, which a huge percentage of the economy actually doesn't get enough green leafy greens, doesn't get enough fiber. So if you find that, in a day doesn't get enough protein, it's very hard to get enough protein actually. That's having to eat a lot of food. If you find that you can't, we can make up that nutrient gap. So it's good with a healthy balanced diet, but if you don't have a healthy balanced diet, this is how you can get your healthy greens for your day.
So that's obviously good, as obviously have our five a day, and not a lot of people don't really have their five a day. So
Yeah.
with the environment, obviously there's a big environment crisis going on at the moment. How does your brand adapt to that, and is your packaging recyclable? How does all that work?
Yeah, so our packaging is recyclable. So this is a cardboard tube. So it's 100% recyclable. So that's how we are adapting to that. And then also our collagen protein. So collagen's usually meat derived. However, this is a vegan collagen, which works very well. It's made up of amino acids, which will provide you with the same amount of collagen and meat-based collagen would as well. So yeah, that's how we're adapting. Being a vegan brand, all of our product ranges vegan, and we use cardboard packaging.
So with your knowledge obviously of food and how you did it, did you take food at school, did you take it at A levels, how did you gather all your knowledge about food?
So my mum is a big herbalist, like a holistic health person, so I feel as though she was the main reason that I found healthy ways to heal myself. My GP, even though he wasn't meant to tell me, because I suffered with eczema for such a long time, he would tell me to look into my diet. Usually they just prescribe you with antihistamines, steroid creams, and things that just temporarily cover the surface, but they don't actually heal the problem. And other GPs that I saw, and still GPs that I see today, if I was to, but I haven't had eczema for so many years now, they would just say, yeah, you're just going to have to be on a pill for the rest of your life. There's nothing you can do about it. But he told me that look into what your body might be allergic to. Like you might be have an intolerance for oranges. That's a big trigger, or bread or something like that. And I found that now, of course, I'm not allergic to oranges, but I found that my body just needed more nutrients, and the nutrients I was getting just wasn't enough. So I needed more than the usual. And I needed to take very nutrient dense ingredients. So I couldn't just take broccoli and peas, but I needed things like neem leaf and moringa, which are very rich and high in vitamin C and D and E and things like that. So it was a combination of just trying to solve my own issues, to be fair.
So on the topic of school, what subjects did you study at school, and did they help you in any way with your business?
Yeah, so I'm very much into maths. So I studied maths, I did maths A levels, maths and further maths, and then I did accounting and finance, which is very maths based. And that helped me hugely in to know the numbers, to keep on looking at the numbers, to feel comfortable looking at numbers. So yeah, that really did help me in business. It helped me to get investment. It helped me on the Gordon Ramsay show. I feel like it will always help me throughout my life, to be fair. So yeah, maths was my favorite subject, still is my favorite subject.
So do you think it's important for children anywhere in the world, and here in the UK and in Nigeria, to get a really good education? Do you think that helps them in their day-to-day life?
100%, I think so. Mathematics, even to today, you know, things like diameter, circumference, and you're like, when are you ever going to use that? We've used it. So when you're asking for packaging, you have to know, okay, it's a diameter of this, or it's the circumference is this for your sizing. So maths is so beneficial. English as well. Of course, we've got ChatGPT now, which can write a lot of copy for you. But if you want to create a very compelling piece of writing, English is so important to sell to people. So yeah, it's really good. It's really good for people in like Nigeria to have that type of basis of education.
So obviously here at TNN, we do lots of promotion in Nigeria, and we do a Feed the Children campaign, which basically gets children together and gives them a whole new opportunity to explore friends and have a good like day out. So is that something you could see yourself maybe getting involved with, like partnering with TNN to help people in Nigeria?
Yes, I would love to do that. I've got a passion for children. Sunmo, actually, so with our planting, Chris, we launched an initiative called Snacks That Give Back, and it's all about giving back a meal to a child that needs it in Nigeria. I was in Nigeria in April, actually, and yeah, went to a couple of slums and I was feeding children out there. So definitely that's something that's very dear to my heart, and I'll be more than happy to volunteer my time and to get involved with that.
Yeah,
And well done to you guys for doing that. Incredible.
absolutely. That's something that I'm very passionate about, and my dad, who is the owner and CEO of TNN, is also really passionate about. So maybe we'll
Incredible.
get in touch with you and sort of look at that. So
Okay.
finally, my final question is, what are your top three favorite foods and why?
Okay. Oh, top three. So my favorite food is actually, do you mean a meal or just ingredients wise?
Ingredients or a meal, it can be
Or a meal.
anything.
Okay, my favorite dish is actually something called amala and owedu. It's a Nigerian dish. So owedu is a very rich leafy green. I feel like I enjoy foods that I can, when I eat them, I feel the nourishment entering my body. I don't know why, but yeah, that makes me feel really good. Like when I eat it just makes me feel amazing. Like I feel to eat it right now, to be honest. So that's my top one, number one, and everything else is just far behind. So I would say, other than that, I love fruits. Mangoes are my go-to. I love some mangoes. And my third will probably be cherries, like really sweet, juicy cherries. Yeah, they're my top three. Yeah.
Amazing. So I would like to thank everybody for watching this podcast. I'd like to thank Victoria for joining me and explaining more about her business and how it is a really good thing for people to have. I'd like everyone to hit the like button and subscribe, and maybe you could see a Sunmo and TNN and collaboration soon in Nigeria with Feed the Children. Thank you, and see you.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Bye, everybody.